So with the recent M3 update, Apple has cleaned up its MacBook lineup quite a bit, but even still, picking one can be tricky. Don't worry, I've tested them all, and hopefully by the end of this video, it'll be a little more clear which you should buy. This is Luke with Digital Trends, and before we get into it, make sure to like this video and subscribe to our channel. It helps us out a ton. I'm going to get into the details of all these different MacBooks that are currently available. But before we do, let's take a step back and see the big picture. So getting right into it, on the surface, there's really only two brands of MacBooks these days, the MacBook Air and the MacBook Pro. The Air is the cheaper and more portable line, whereas the Pro is the larger and more powerful. Where these two meet in the middle can get into a gray area, but in broad strokes, that remains true regardless of which model you're looking at. When you start to get into the individual laptops though, it gets far more complex. There are actually six different MacBooks that Apple currently sells, three in each brand. So let me list them all out for you, starting down at the bottom in terms of price, which is the M1 MacBook Air. That's followed by the 13-inch M2 MacBook Air, and then finally the 15-inch M2 MacBook Air. From there, you have the M3 14-inch MacBook Pro, the M3 Pro or Max MacBook Pro, and finally the M3 Pro or Max 16-inch MacBook Pro. Now that Apple removed the 13-inch MacBook Pro, the line is broken up into these two segments pretty clearly, and there are no longer any clear options that nobody should buy outright. Now, it really comes down to finding the right MacBook for you in terms of price and use case. So let's get into that next. So starting with the MacBook Airs, the M1 MacBook Air is easily the oldest and most outdated laptop in the lineup, featuring not only a chip from 2020, but a design from 2018 actually. Apple sells this thing for $999, but you can find some killer deals out there. It's commonly sold for under $700, and that rock bottom price is really what makes me feel okay recommending it still, even in 2023. There haven't been MacBooks selling for this cheap in a long time, and the M1 chip still holds up pretty well, especially if you just need something basic, both in terms of performance and in battery life. I wouldn't, however, buy this at full price because Apple only charges an extra $100 for the M2 MacBook Air, and there's a pretty big difference in between these two. This is not just a difference in performance. The M2 MacBook Air is a full redesign of its predecessor that's more modern and sleek in pretty much every way. It's thinner, the bezels are way slimmer, the keyboard is improved, and it even has that MagSafe 3 power jack. And of course, the M2 MacBook Air does outperform the M1. I just wouldn't put too much emphasis there on determining which to buy, because if you're buying an Air, you're not someone who's sitting in front of Final Cut or Pro Tools or Cinema 4D all day. These are machines that can dabble in some media and content creation, but in general, it's not the right choice for those who do that for a living. So when it comes down to it, the M2 is more powerful, but if you've already decided that you're a better fit for the Air, your day-to-day is probably gonna be impacted more by having a more mobile device with a better screen, a better webcam and speakers and keyboard, all of which the M2 MacBook Air has. So unless you find a mind-blowing deal and don't mind an older-looking laptop, the M2 MacBook Air really is the way to go. So then what about this newest addition to the Air family, the 15-inch MacBook Air? This one's interesting in a lot of ways, coming a full year after the 13-inch M2 MacBook Air. When configured equally, the 15-inch model is sold for only $100 more than the 13-inch model, and that is going to be a trend you'll see throughout this video, because that is just the way Apple gets you to pay a little bit more and more and more and add up to you spending a ton of money. But what you're paying for in this case with that extra money is pretty much exclusively a larger screen. And I know the difference between a 13.6-inch screen and a 15.3-inch screen doesn't sound like a lot, but remember, those refer to diagonal measurements of the screen. The 15-inch MacBook Air really is a large laptop. It might not fit well into a small briefcase or on a tiny lecture hall desk in the same way the 13-inch model will, and it's certainly not going to matter if you spend all your time docked to an external monitor anyways. But for those that sit at a desk all day and really could use that extra space for split view multitasking, the 15-inch MacBook Air is the way to go. Side note, if you have trouble with vision for whatever reason, the 15-inch screen really is a lifesaver. The only caveat here is that it starts at a higher configuration, so you don't get the same option for a cheaper, less powerful model with just 8 GPU cores instead of 10. But otherwise, it has the same exact chip inside, gets that same incredible battery life, and is almost nearly as thin. It just might not be your ultimate travel machine like the 13-inch model is. Now, as we turn to the Pro machines, there's certainly a line in the sand here. However, the two MacBooks that straddle that line are pretty close in function, and it'll require some close inspection to know which you should buy. So if you're considering either the 15-inch MacBook Air or the 14-inch M3 MacBook Pro, the middle of the road MacBook, so to speak, there are some important distinctions to make. But first off, when configured both at 8 GB of memory and 512 GB of storage, the two laptops are only $100 apart. Remember, it's coming back again, that $100. So as of now, what you're getting for that $100 is two things. First, a much better XDR screen that's brighter, more colorful, and faster with its 120Hz refresh rate. No laptop these days does HDR content quite like this thing. And the second thing you're getting is more ports. You still can't connect to more than a single display, I know, but you do get HDMI and an SD card slot. More than anything, of course, you'll get some much better performance though. The M3 brings better multi-core and GPU performance over the M2, around 20% faster in my testing. That might sound like a pretty good deal, but here's the thing. I don't know that the M3 alone gets you something that a pro would want to use on a daily basis. Could get the job done, but serious creative professionals are going to be tempted by the upgrade to the M3 Pro or Max, and I'll get to that. And I will say there's a trade-off primarily in portability. The 14-inch MacBook Pro is 28% thicker and 21% heavier than the 15-inch MacBook Air, despite the fact that the Air is actually slightly wider and deeper. But the Pro really is a bit of a chunker, to be honest. This is the chassis of a laptop that can handle a much more powerful chip, namely the M3 Max, and that makes this feel like a bit of a trap. Of all the MacBooks in the lineup, this one feels like it has the most unclear demographic, other than people who think they want or need a Pro laptop, but can't quite afford one. Not unlike the 13-inch MacBook Pro it replaced. This is a better option in almost every way than that old thing, but in the end, it's for that aspiring hobbyist, the one that spends late nights and weekends working on their creative projects. This thing will likely be a stretch for that person to afford without giving them the tool they need to go all in. And that's why choosing between the 15-inch Air and the 14-inch Pro requires a hard look in the mirror about how you actually will use this device. Especially since an update to the M3 for the Air is at least a few months away, if not more. Make no mistake though, at some point in the near future, these two MacBooks will be closer to even footing in terms of performance, which will make that M3 MacBook Pro feel even more out of place. And all that brings me to the final piece of the puzzle, the 14-inch and 16-inch MacBook Pros with either the M3 Pro or M3 Max inside. Here's what I can unabashedly say. The M3 Max is quite an accomplishment for Apple. The graphics in particular are the most powerful they've ever had, even allowing you to turn your MacBook into a pretty decent gaming machine on the side. And I'm not kidding about that. I know there aren't a ton of games available right now, but from a performance perspective, it's pretty great. The M3 Pro, though, is kind of a different story. Now, very few have tested that configuration as of now, and we're gonna see more and more testing to confirm all this in the future, but it's clear that the gap between the M3 Pro and the M3 Max has widened in this generation, despite the price difference remaining the same. There's a performance bump over the M3 and M2 Pro for sure, and the M3 Pro gets you support for two external 4K monitors, and that's a big deal. And more than that, going for the M3 Pro MacBook Pro gets you access to Space Black. Now, I know that there are people out there who are willing to fork over extra cash just to get Space Black, and I get it. This is my favorite color of all the MacBooks by far too. Just know that if you are going for the M3 Pro, the performance upgrade is just not as big in this generation as it was in the previous one. So if you want that true high-end performance, it's really all about the M3 Max. And it really is worth the money, and even more so now that the M3 Pro has been held back a bit. And that is saying something when the starting price is $3,200 for this thing. But with graphics that I tested at 50% faster than the M2 Max, this is a huge upgrade, especially if you're doing anything that involves GPU rendering. And even more so if you're coming from the M1 or earlier. So that's the chips themselves, but there's also two MacBook Pro sizes to choose from, the 14-inch and the 16-inch. And as always, screen size is a matter of personal taste and need. If you want a bigger screen and don't mind the size and heft of this 4.7 pound laptop, there's no reason not to go for the 16 inch model. You won't see a huge performance difference, but it has better speakers, slightly stronger battery life, and it isn't forced to run its fans quite as hard. The larger screen is also good for reducing the feeling of the notch taking over your entire laptop screen, because it's less likely to get in the way with that bigger screen. Personally though, I do love the compact size of the 14 inch model. It's really become my go-to laptop, and it still blows my mind how much performance they're able to get out of this small laptop. Now, before we get to the end here, a few closing notes on memory and storage. Apple is notorious for charging ridiculous prices for both, but especially for storage. I mean, it's great that you can add 8 terabytes of storage on the M3 Max MacBook Pro, but you're gonna be paying an extra $2,200 for it. That's the price of an entire new MacBook Pro. And remember, both storage and memory are soldered on, so you can't upgrade in the future. That's why most people will opt for using external storage rather than paying thousands of dollars for extra terabytes. Now onto memory, and this has become quite a controversy these days, but Apple loves to talk about how its unified memory means 8 gigabytes on a Mac is actually equivalent to 16 gigabytes on a Windows PC. And I know what they're saying, but in most cases that probably won't be true. It's just not hard to fill up more than 8 gigabytes of available memory with a fairly basic load in, you know, Google Chrome. And that's especially true on these Pro models when you're gonna be throwing a lot more at it and a lot more at the same time. I'd say that if you're getting an M1 MacBook Air or something like that, sticking with 8 gigabytes is probably okay. But I'd say if you're going for any of those advanced MacBook Pro models, 16 gigabytes is a minimum and 32 gigabytes would be a nice upgrade for creative pros. Maxing out with either 96 or 128 gigabytes is for a very specific type of person. And just as a rule of thumb, you kind of know who you are if you need that much memory. There's much more that can be said about each of these individual laptops, obviously, but I'm gonna leave it at that for now because I wanna know which of these MacBooks you have and what was your biggest reason for choosing it and which of these are you looking to upgrade to. So leave me a comment down below and I'll see you in the next one.